Hello and welcome back to the Satanic Media Agenda Exposed. We have another session, perhaps the last one, I believe, of Queen dealing with the Freddie Mercury and his band and all of his, very popular, very flamboyant, as we can call it, songwriting. So, Michael, welcome.
Hello, dear Brett, and hello, dear listeners out there. This is another and definitely the last session on Queen, because we did Queen for special purposes, and the script in German was already finished and recorded and also published, so that it was just a natural thing to come out in English, because we know that in the English spoken countries, Queen was highly popular in the 70s and 80s. So this is the last session on Queen. And you're free to participate, or you're free to have another opinion, but please don't use rude language or rude comments, because we also do not blame anyone. It's just our opinion, it's our research on base of the King James Bible 1611. And this is definitely the last session. Okay. The interpretation of Bohemian Rhapsody, in my humble opinion, is the commitment of Freddie Mercury that Freddie Mercury has contact with Satan or the devil himself. Beelzebub has put a devil, the devil aside me. And he's also using Bismillah, which is a formula or a verse beginning of the Quran, which says in the name of the Almighty God, but it's a God of the Islamic people. So we know that Freddie Mercury was not Islamic in his belief, as we don't know what his belief actually is. I'd say that his belief is purely satanic, and that Zoroastrian only is a disguise for the people. But you see that in the light of the Bible, Zoroastrian also is satanic, of course, because every religion who does not claim that Jesus Christ is the Savior and Jesus Christ is Lord must come from the devil. So it's just the same either way around. You don't need a Church of Satan by the actor Anton Sanolawe, which is not his real name. Also, I think he's a prolific actor. You don't need the Church of Satan to have a satanic church. You don't need Zoroastrian to have a different or a pagan belief system. Every belief system which does not include that the Almighty Lord has created the earth is pagan. So if people are in evolution theory, they don't believe in the Lord God, in the Almighty God of the Bible. So it's, if you're believing the evolution theory, or if you're a Zoroastrian, or if you're whatever, if you're a member of the Church of Satan, in the end it comes down all again the same road, and it's not the straight narrow path. And music and media is just a tool to distract you from the road, to distract you from reading the Bible, because that, oh, in our so-called modern times with all the information highways, who reads books anyway? Okay, last session on Queen. This was the actual picture where we have stopped last time and where we start this time. So we go into some things of Persian symbols. Because Zoroastrian actually comes down from Persia, or nowadays called Iran. But you know that Persian symbols are very old. In some altered versions, the Huma bird, speaking H-U-M-A, is depicted similar to the phoenix. And we know that the symbol of the phoenix, if you remember, is hanging on top of Queen. So, it consumes itself in the fire after a few hundred years and rises anew from its own ashes. This bird is also referred to as the bird of paradise. It consists of the physical features of both male and female in one body. Oh, where do we know that from, Brad?
Oh, the blasphemy.
Yeah. Correct. Yeah. Each nature consists of one wing and one leg. Catching a Huma bird is impossible, as the legend explains. According to the Sufi religion, the Huma bird cannot be caught alive, and the person who kills it dies in 40 days. Oh, 40 days. Where do we know that from?
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah, you see? All these references, all these symbols, all this numerology.
We're mixing it all up, aren't we?
Mixing all the holy with the profane. Yeah. So, what about the Huma bird? The Huma, Persian pronounced Homa, also Homa, is a mythical bird of Iranian legend and fables and continuing as a common motif in Sufi and Divan poetry. Although there are many legends of this creature, common to all is that the bird is said never to alight on the ground and instead to live its entire life flying invisibly high above the earth. Oh, there are many things who are invisible to the human eye, aren't they, Brad?
Yeah. Right.
Also in our modern times. Yeah. There are numerous folk interpretations of the name, among them of the Sufi teacher Inayat Khan, who supposed that, quote, in the word Huma, Hu represents spirit, and the word Ma originates from the Arabic Ma'a, which means water. So, speaking of the bird that is never said to never alight on the ground and instead to live its entire life flying invisibly high above the earth. Oh, it must be a spirit. So I would agree to Inayat Khan that some of the Huma word represents spirit. I highly agree on that. And you know that spirit, high, flying high above the air invisibly, would be in accordance to Ephesians 2:2. I'm sorry that I haven't put it here in English, but you see that it's about the prince of the power of the air, which is Satan. And of course, any mythical bird of Iranian legend and fables has come from the origin of Satan, because there are no mythical birds. Yeah, every mythical means a mystery, and it's all futile. They're all mythical things like vampires and everything else. Yeah, they do not exist. So, we know that Huma is consisting of spirit and water. The bird of paradise. The Huma bird is a legendary and mythical figure. We know that. It was believed that in the olden times, that if this legendary creature sat on the head of an individual, then it was an omen to the person become a king. Oh, momento, momento, momento. I have to skip back. What's that?
Yeah, that's right. You know, as long as you're on this image, Michael, I was never noticing this before until you just were introducing the topic today, that on the crown in the queue of the Queen logo here, that we see before us, we see two fleur-de-lis, and then we see the, what is this called? The Maltese cross, or the, what's, there's probably other names for it. And then above that, we see the plus, which is supposedly a symbol for Christianity, which it is not, it's pagan. Yeah. So yeah, I mean, how much more pagan can you get? I mean, incredible.
I totally agree, and I think there's also more to it, because you see
that
it's not a normal queue. Yeah. So if we know that the zero or the circle or whatever represents spirit, and what's that? That's like a snake tail.
Well, have you seen this belt that goes in a loop like that and has the extra bit hanging down? Like on this Great Britain, there's some Latin in the title.
On this coat of arms, you mean?
Yeah, coat of arms, right. Yeah. So, yeah. I mean, I've seen that in bars too, where they mimic this. So it's very common, actually. Yeah, there's some beer that mimics that belt logo. Yeah,
Yeah, but you see that this is not a regular cue.
No, no.
Yeah, this is bending here, sharply bending. And of course, that's also a depiction here of, could be a depiction of a tail. So this is just my interpretation. But you see that he's sitting here, the phoenix bird or the huma bird in the Zoroastrian belief system is sitting on top of everything. And there is also a crown. And the crown depicts some a king, of course. Yeah, and he's speaking of queen. Yeah, because you see that there are many resemblances here of the queen of heaven or of his being a queer, being homosexual, whatever. But you see that it's about the humor bird at the moment. Mm-hmm. And I found it very interesting that it was an omen to the person becoming a king if that legendary creature sat on the head on an individual. And he's sitting here on the head of the queue of the band Queen. So the queens are becoming the king. The queen members are becoming kings of the earth or the merchants of the earth. And that's why I ask you to read Revelation 18 in the last session. In the word Huma, Hu represents the spirit and the word Ma is Arabic. I don't know why it has been inserted in Arabic language in a Zoroastrian thing, but anyway, if it's correct, which represents water. And you see that it is in the Bible verse of John 3:5 that Jesus said, right?
Ah, yes. John 3:5, Jesus answered, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God."
This is that very creature depicted here on Wikipedia, and doesn't look nice at all. It sounds like a carnivore, a hunter. Yeah, it does not look like it's eating plants and grass. So, this griffin-like column capital statuary from about 500 before Christ in Persepolis in Iran or Persia. In local popular interpretation, the figure on these columns, which are forbidden in the Bible anyway, are perceived as representations of the so-called humor bird. And why did I read, or Brett read, the verse? You see, humor is hu, water, and or hu is spirit, and ma is water. So, born of water, spirit.
Oh, but the other way around.
yeah, it's the other way around. Yeah, wow. But you see that Hu is spirit and Ma is water, which leads to human.
Interesting.
What did Jesus Christ said? Except a man be born of water and of spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God.
That's pretty heavy duty, Michael.
Yeah, this is my interpretation that humanos, yeah, which means man, yeah, or manly, derives from humor bird. You see that if Hu is spirit and Ma is water, then it's
that's humor. Really interesting. Yeah, because it's just humor with an N on it.
Yeah, you see that there are depictions of humor birds in the so-called Gate of All Nations in Iran. And in the British Museum catalog captures a photograph of the griffin-like capitals at Persepolis with column capital in the form of griffins, locally known as Homa birds or Huma birds. You know that Homa and Huma is the same. Yeah, there are these columns. And of course, these columns are things in, I think, that Deuteronomy forbids to erect any pillars in the Bible. Yeah, these are all pillars in the all pillars in any religion are symbols of pagan belief systems. And if you see birds or whatever, they are a symbol mostly for the spirit. Because,
you know, Michael, if you don't mind, I looked up human on the etymology online, and it's interesting. They say, from Latin humanus, quote, of man, human, unquote. Also, quote, humane, philanthropic, mm-hmm. kind, mm-hmm. gentle, polite, learned, refined, civilized, unquote. It just reminds me of, you know, you've heard of these philanthropic people like, you know, we have today, right? Bill Gates with him and his, you know, here's the Mongol, the computer Mongol Bill Gates, all of a sudden in the realm of health, of all things. How strange. How can people just go along with this World Health Organization? But yeah, philanthropy. I mean, it's pretty disgusting, actually.
You see, concerning to Bill Gates, I think that the person behind Bill Gates is, first of all, in the worldly
absolutely
affairs, is his father.
Yes, that's correct.
You have to look at his father. And I think then you will understand a little bit more of Bill Gates, but it's not part of the reading here.
No. We're way off on a tangent here.
See that if you look up to the etymology online, you will see that it derives from Latin. But you see that the Latin language is not that old as the Persian language or cultural.
Yeah, right. Medo-Persia, the empire goes back before Greece even. So
yeah, way back before the Roman Empire.
It's really interesting. I had asked someone, or I had gotten a response from a question I asked online, that if any of our listeners would know anything about the Medo-Persian Empire, if they would just send something, and someone did. And it had everything to do with traditions, Michael. So that's just in a nutshell. I mean, I'm not going into any details here, but please, Michael, I didn't mean to distract from your lesson.
No. But I always insist on going back to the foundation, to going back to the oldest available language or the oldest words. Yeah. And
wow.
So
this
picture depicts the so-called Gate of All Nations with the depiction of the Huma birds on this
columns. Oh my.
And the depiction here on the stones on the walls. And I said that I think in Deuteronomy it is that it is forbidden to erect any pillar. So any pillar.
Yeah. This looks Babylonian.
Of any temple.
But this is Persian, you're saying?
Hmm?
This is Persian?
This is it's called Iran, so it's the same as Persia. Persia is the old name.
Yeah. Wow, that's fascinating, Michael.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Yeah. Good find.
Forgotten Empire, uh-huh. Yeah. Yes. And you see that despite of anything else, this Huma bird we saw before with a sharp mouth, you see that this Huma bird seems to be a carnivore.
Ah, yes,
seems
Michael.
To be a predator.
Let me quick finish my thought on that because I didn't quite explain myself. I had asked someone online about Medo-Persia, Greece, and Rome. Well, of course, yeah, Babylon as being the very foundation of it all, being the dream that Nebuchadnezzar had, you know, in the book of Daniel. That's in reference to that. I just want to make sure everyone knows, especially those that don't read the Bible and don't know the scriptures, that there is a metal man image that Nebuchadnezzar had in his dream, and he was not able to even remember the dream that he had. But he required one of the wise men in that realm to explain to him his dream, and no one could do it but the prophet Daniel. So that's a really interesting study that people can do, and it's very, very, very important to the very fundamentals of our faith in Christianity to know that book of Daniel, because it is a prophetic book, just like the book of Revelation is a prophetic book, and very, very misinterpreted and used and indoctrinated false teachings. So you have all these false prophets going around teaching lies, and they're not biblical truths. And that's because we have just incredible corruption today, and the foundation of which is derived from Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, and Rome. And here we go. Medo-Persia, Michael. I just love it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, these were the ancient times. And you see that nothing new under the sun. You see, this is the same shape and the same form as in the Roman Empire or in the United States Colosseum. So what really has changed?
Nothing.
Nothing.
Nothing has changed. What they've done is they've built principles and precepts based on quote-unquote huma bird or human, whatever you want to call it, Latin, having to do with, making a structure, if you will, a spiritual structure of mankind, right? Not a spiritual structure of Jesus Christ. No, we can't have that. See, that's not do as thou wilt shall be the whole of the law. We can't have that. We gotta have do as thou wilt shall be the whole of the law. You can do anything you want. Great. But that's what they've given us. I mean, that's really the world as we know it. It's just a free-for-all. Which is totally depraved and of no real value at all. But, you know, you got to figure that out for yourself. I'm just speaking freely here. It's really interesting, though, Michael, to take a look at this. So please, I'm sorry, I interrupted. I just had to spurt that out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're free whenever you are. Have something to contribute. You see that this humor bird is so old, and I think that it could be the real origin of the word human. But there's also another thing, because we saw the picture of this humor bird, and it seems to be a carnivore, it seems to be a predator. And this is quite in opposition to the Bible, because in the Bible, predators are being described as from the so-called other side evil things. Yeah, it's just a symbol. I'm not mocking anyone who has a cat in his home or a dog or anyone who is eating meat. It's just for the for depicting something, and they are depicting here birds inside a temple. You see, these are no actual animals. This is a depiction and it's a symbol. So in symbolism, a carnivore, a predator, stands for the dark side, for the evil side, because he's killing. And in the Bible, animals for good purposes are, for example, the lamb, which has not to kill to eat or to survive. So you see that that's quite the other way around, and that's why I used here a biblical verse, because originally in the Garden of Eden everybody was eating vegetables and the green grass and everything that God has ordained, and there was no killing, there was no death in the world in the Garden of Eden. And also, this has a big symbolical meaning. You see that here in Matthew 3:16, you see also a reference.
Right. Oh, yes. And Jesus, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water. And lo, the heavens were opened unto him. And he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove, and lightning excuse me, and lighting upon him. Not lightning, lighting.
Yeah. You see, the Spirit of God, like a dove, not a dove, but like a dove. Yeah, and a dove makes no harm. Oh, it's really interesting that nowadays people think that doves are really a plague. And people think that, oh, doves are really, they are not useful, not necessary at all. They have to get rid of them. But in the Bible,
they're a nuisance, Michael. A nuisance. Yeah. People can refer to them as a nuisance, what would you say, a squirrel with wings or something like that.
Yeah, but you see that in the Bible, it's been depicted symbolized like a dove. Yeah, and dove, they don't have to kill for eating meat.
Right.
They don't have to. They are not like the Huma bird. So you see, there's also a big difference in that. But anyway, let's move on. Yeah, I'd say that that is really a strange thing. It could be a dragon or what else, but it's a strange thing. This is a simurgh. Welcome to a simurgh. An ancient Persian mythological bird. This immortal, gigantic, female-winged creature is usually described as having a scale-covered body with a dog's head and foreparts, lion claws, and peacock's wings and tails. It's also depicted sometimes with a human face. Quite coincidence, huh? The simurgh was considered a benevolent guardian figure with protective and healing powers. It was believed to purify the waters and the land and bestow fertility. It was also seen as a messenger or mediator between the sky and the earth and symbolic of the union. The simurgh is mentioned quite frequently in classical as well as modern Persian literature used specifically in Sufi mysticism as a metaphor for God.
Yes, metaphor, Michael.
Metaphor,
yes.
The mystical bird appears in several old tales of creation. According to Persian legends, the simurgh was very old, so much so that it has witnessed the world's destruction thrice. Yeah, that's mythology, huh? Mm-hmm. You can witness things which did not happen. Yeah, but you see, this is mythology. And this is human league. I think it's a very well-known band from the United Kingdom with songs like Don't You Want Me Baby or The Lebanon or Open Your Heart or Love Action or simply Human. And the main line in that verse is I'm only human of flesh and blood. I'm made human, born to make mistakes. So, where's the spirit here? You are made to believe that you just consist of flesh and blood. Yeah? Where's the spirit?
It's been extracted.
Yeah.
Doesn't exist.
It doesn't exist.
In denial.
Yeah, so this is the Satanic Media Exposed, which means that the Human League wants to believe you that you only consist of flesh and you only have to fulfill your fleshly lusts in listening to loud music and being distracted and enjoying your life so that you don't have to concern to listen to all these sessions which we are doing here. What I really want to point out that in Persian belief, they not only have a Huma bird or what was it again? A simurgh. Yeah, it's all immortal things and mythology. You see, the simurgh is also immortal like the phoenix or the Huma bird is. Yeah, they're all immortal. They have some godly features included. So, this sounds like mythology, and this sounds also like magic. And what was it in Queen's discography? It's a kind of magic.
Mm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I have to look it up. Yeah, Look at that. Marcus is a follower of Zoroastrianism. You know that the Acts chapter 8, Simon Magus arrived.
Oh, jeez.
Simon the sorcerer would be, according to Wikipedia, a follower of Zoroastrianism. And we know what Simon the sorcerer did: want to buy the Holy Spirit from the apostles. And he was a man who was big and, So Astrium.
Yeah, a man that was supposedly the power of God. Or how did that scripture go? Let me look that up again. You said Acts 8.
Mm-hmm.
Acts 8.
Yeah. I think it was Acts 8.
I'll find it. Mm-hmm. Go ahead. Sorry.
Yeah, because Jörg, Brett, and me, we did a study of the book of Acts, I think 1 year ago or whatever. And we saw that the Roman Catholic belief system is based upon the foundation of Simon Magus, not Simon Peter. And so Magus is a title. It's not an actual name. It's like Lucifer is a title of the light bearer. And not the light itself, but the light bearer. So Magus is also a title. Magus is called a follower of Zoroastrianism or Zoroaster. How can that be?
Yeah, here, let's just quick read Acts chapter 8, verse 9 and 10 and maybe 11 too. But there was a certain man called Simon, which before time in the same city used sorcery and bewitched the people of Samaria, giving out that himself was some great one, to whom they all gave heed from the least to the greatest, saying, "This man is the great power of God." And to him they had regard because of that long time he had bewitched them with sorceries.
Bewitched them. Mr. Simon Magus did bewitch them. Mm-hmm.
Isn't it interesting, Michael? I think if I search, I can only find one scripture in the entire Bible that speaks of bewitching.
Mm-hmm.
And this is it.
Mm-hmm. Well, and to say that the common knowledge is that Magus is a follower of Zoroastrianism. So it comes down from Persia.
Oh, no. I'm wrong. It's also in Galatians.
Yeah, okay. That does not put anything away from your quote, you see.
No, of course not. But I just want to let everyone know. There are three verses. Huh? It's Acts 9, Acts 11. Excuse me, Acts chapter 8, verse 9, chapter 8, verse 11, and Galatians chapter 3, verse 1. So, good enough.
So we know that Magus is a follower of Zoroastrianism. That's how the cookie crumbles. And now read that. Magus is one of the biblical magi. Magi? The magician. So, what's a magi? Magi, singular magus, from Latin magus, were priests in Zoroastrianism. So, the priests of Zoroastrianism belief system were magicians. Now, I think there should ring a big bell.
Yeah.
Because if one would really practice Zoroastrianism as a priest, he would be called a magician. He would be a magus. And therefore, he would be a sorcerer.
Right.
That's especially right. Especially those who has depicted his own band symbol.
With
a humor part.
Michael, can I ask you a question? Would sorcerers participate in rituals?
Yeah.
So the word R-I-T-E is just something that every Bible believer should just look down on in shame.
Mm-hmm.
I think so.
Yeah,
read
please this line for yourself or out.
Mm.
The earliest known use. Please read that.
Mm. Yes, the earliest known use of the word magi is in the trilingual inscription written by Darius the Great, known as the Behistun inscription.
Yeah.
Old Persian texts predating the Hellenistic period refer to a magus as a Zervanic and presumably Zoroastrian priest. Ay, ay, ay.
Yeah, that means that if Freddie Mercury uses his name Mercury as a messenger of the gods, he would be preaching with his microphone out in the open in front of the public with concerts, and his symbol of the band Queen would also confirm that he really knows what he's talking about.
And we have to mention the fact that Jörg Lissmann and I and Michael, all three of us together, made a session in the reading of the book, The Great Exodus or The Time of the End, How Near Are We to It? You can look in the playlist and you'll find a thumbnail of this Behistun inscription, which is a gigantic rock face way up high on a mountain, rock mountain, that is ancient, and it shows you the Behistun inscription. You can refer to that video and watch it if you want more information as to that study we did. But this makes perfect sense, Michael.
Mm-hmm. Okay, then we move on. Yeah, that's the magus is the older word for a practitioner of magic, to include astronomy, astrology, alchemy, and other forms of esoteric knowledge.
Mm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that comes actually from the magi, which were the priests of Zoroastrian. There the word magic derives from.
We could say other forms of esoteric knowledge equals
Gnostic.
What?
Yeah.
Yeah. Equals what? Fill in the blank. What is the blank? The blank is sorceries.
Mm. Yeah, you see, that is survives in the modern day words magic and magician. Yeah?
Yeah, that reminds me of that verse in Revelation where it says...
There you got your favorite quote.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. It's,
the Magi for the impious
by and sorceries. Yeah. By sorceries, all nations were deceived, right?
Yeah.
You remember this verse?
Yeah.
I can look it up, Michael.
We have named this series Satanic Media Exposed, and the media is the medium between God and the people.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Yeah. This is the media. The media is not a television station. The media is not a book. The mediums, the media is just the common description of anything which is in the middle between two parties. And the one party is coming from above, as above, so below. The one party is coming from the so-called gods or magicians or whatever. And the other party are the buyers of the records, which believe that, Killer Queen is just a fancy record, has nothing to do with the terror act. And you see that Bohemian Rhapsody is just a fancy opera, has nothing to do with the contract or the devil itself. This is what they want to, that we believe that it's just an art form. But these art forms are actually, it's a kind of chance, Brett. Chance.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yep. So the end of the verse in Revelation chapter 18:23 says, "For thy merchants were the great men of the earth, for by all their sorceries," I'm adding that, "for by thy sorceries were all nations deceived." I'm a little tongue-tied this morning, Michael. Yeah.
It's good for me because then my bad English doesn't take into account that much.
yeah, that's right. That's fine, Michael. Yeah. Don't worry about that.
You see here, in the Roman period, once the Magi, so the sorcerer, had been associated with magic, Greek, magikos, it was but a natural progression that the Greek's image of Zoroaster would metamorphose into a magician too. For Pliny, this magic was a monstrous craft. What was it in the Bohemian Rhapsody again? Spare him his life of this monstrosity. For Pliny, this magic was a monstrous craft that gave the Greeks not only a, quote, lust for magic, but a downright, quote, madness for it. And Pliny supposed that Greek philosophers, among them Pythagoras, Empedocles, Democritus, and Plato, traveled abroad to study it. It means magic. And then returned to teach it. It means magic.
Yeah.
The simple word it, IT, means not information technology, means magic here.
Yeah, well, sorcerers.
Magikos.
Yeah.
Magikos, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Esoteric knowledge.
Yeah. In Christian tradition, there is a deception of the three magi. Uh-huh. What did they do? There were three in the King James Bible. They're not depicted as magi, but three wise men.
Big difference.
Big difference. Because yes, that when people are starting to be wise, the beginning of wisdom is the fear of the Lord.
There we go. That's the biblical version.
That's the biblical version. What did these three wise men do? They came from the east. They followed a star, so that many people, including myself years ago, thought they were astronomers. And they were handing over presents to the child Jesus. But there were three wise men because they were fearing of the Lord. Mm-hmm. Therefore, there could not be three magi.
Yes, and the Bible also explains this false description here. Professing themselves to become wise, they became fools.
Romans 1:22, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Michael's favorite.
No, Jörg's favorite, that's why.
Ah, Jörg's too, both of you, yeah.
Yeah, it's not my favorite, actually. My favorite is maybe Luke 4:6 or so. I it depends on the mood and depends on the subject, which is
Of course. Yeah. What rings the bells, so to speak? Biblical bells, not Babylonian ones or whatever.
Yeah, bell is also an instrument which is highly being regarded as being used in a ritual.
Well, the question is, Michael, does it ring true?
Yeah.
You know, there's a certain ring to the truth, isn't there?
I think it rings very loud when you see that these
alarm bells, yeah.
This three wise men are being described as wise men because they, I will solve it now.
So this is the indoctrination they fill us with. Yeah, exactly. So
these are no magi. This is wrong.
Magi. Oh, they don't mention Simon Magus now, do they?
No. But you see that I have forgotten to highlight here in light green the color of witchcraft. Because there are no biblical magi who were serving Jesus Christ. You see that magi must be one who is a sorcerer and the origin of the word coming down from a Zoroastrian priest. So they cannot serve Jesus Christ. You cannot serve two masters.
Yeah.
And they were never mentioned in the Bible that their names would be Balthazar and Caspar and Melchior. This is all mythically BS. Mm-hmm. Lack of a better word.
Well, you know, Michael, we have a great appreciation for your study you've done and taking the time to make this in English. And I certainly understand not having in that in green. And, you know, there's no way we're going to miss that. Biblical magi is an oxymoron, right?
Yeah. Correct. Absolutely.
Absolutely correct. A huge fallacy.
It's like putting out that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and saying that he hasn't fulfilled the 70th week of Daniel. Yeah,
that's correct. It's mythology.
It's on a different level, but actually it's an oxymoron as well.
Yes.
And that's why I have here highlighted the wise man, King James Version, wise man, because I thought that the King James Version translators were so wise men that they know the difference between wise men and magi.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah, because you see that origin, of course, from the Alexandrian stream, they translated as magicians.
Oh, of course. Yes.
Of course. Because it's not the purified Bible.
Because you have to use magic
stream.
To be wise, Michael.
Yeah.
You need a magisterium in your church, damn it.
Oh, yeah. I think I have to skip the page. Yeah, I think that the listeners will receive and understand the point. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, the three wise men to seek the infant Jesus. Yeah, they were wise to do so, and they were sent by God. Otherwise, they wouldn't have found him.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's my belief. So, in Arabic, magicians, there's a C missing here, Majus, is the term for Zoroastrians. The term is mentioned in the Quran. Ah, interesting, huh? Surah 22, verse 17, where the magicians or Magians are mentioned alongside the Jews, the Sabians, and the Christians in a list of religions who will be judged on the day of resurrection besides idolaters. Ah, okay.
Idolaters, Michael.
Idolaters. What a coincidence with the revelation of the Bible, huh?
Yeah.
What a revelation. And in 1918, Saddam Hussein, being the leader of the Iraq, so not the Iran, but the Iraq, used the term Majus during the Iran-Iraq war as a generalization of all modern-day Iranians. Interesting, huh? So he made also the reference that the hardcore Persians, Iranians, he called Majus, he called Magi.
Mm.
So it's not us alone or etymology or whatever, but also the Saddam Hussein. I know these.
But to be fair to all of the Iranians, you know, that's just a tradition, just like we have these quote unquote Catholic traditions here.
Yeah, of course. Of
Christianity. And, you know, tradition in a nutshell is bad news. Sorry to say. Sad to say. But it's not always good, you know. Even Christian tradition needs to be subjected to the Bible. Let's be good Bereans. Let's get into the scriptures and let's break it down to its foundation. Right, mm-hmm. Michael?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, just I thought, what would be a good idea to quote Saddam Hussein? But you see that he's got a bar.
No, this is good.
Yeah, you see a bath party, you see that bar, everything that starts with B-A, you see that not Barabbas, but Baal. Yeah, you see that.
Oh, yeah, good point.
Yeah, mm-hmm. You see that I'm sympathizing with Saddam Hussein, of course. He was just a puppet. But you see that it's just about his using of words, which was interesting. Yeah, and also, there are many, many references around the world from the old Persian Magus, magician, Magi. So you see that here in just a short three words, Magus, magician, Magi. Yeah. So this is also Christian holidays. There are no Christian holidays except on the Sabbath. But holy days.
Well, that's a good point, Michael. You know, and why do we have these traditions in our so-called churches? You know, they're really just another arm of this metal man image coming into the holiest of holies, if you will, you know, which is what we should believe. It's our faith, our basis for faith in practice should be our Bible, right? But we have huge corruptions, Michael. So yeah, to call a Christian holiday biblical, it's another indoctrination.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. Fully agree with you, Michael.
Yeah, you see that all these things, you see that the holiday is a secular thing also, yeah, which means that states ordain that you have to avoid work and that you are not allowed to do this or that. On a so-called holy day, but you see that that's not the point of this discussion here at the moment. But you see that the origin of the word sorcery or Zaubern in German comes from the the Dutch word tover, and also from the Old English, Old Saxony word tiver for red color or scarlet. And it was used for the writing of the so-called runes. And the runes, this is a what do I say?
You said red color scarlet, right? Yeah, I just couldn't quite hear your voice.
Yeah, it's some kind of red color, so I suppose it's scarlet then. And yes, you see, these are also being used, this red color, for runes. But I don't know if it's a correct word in American English, runes, because you see that...
Oh,
that,
runes, like runestones?
Yes, correct, yes.
Right, it is. That's absolutely right.
Okay, yeah. So but you see that also here in German Wikipedia tells about the name sorcerer as someone who knows, someone of knowledge, which is identical with the Persian magicians or the Latin vates, the Celtic druids, the dervish, and the English wizards and witches. Also, the old Egyptian god Thoth was responsible for writing science and magic. And you see that I think it's all about that it's the opposition of worshiping Jesus Christ, because they are worshiping Satan.
Absolutely.
And at least in the Romans chapter 14:11, it has been said what will happen then when Jesus Christ returns.
All right, Romans 14:11.
Mm-hmm.
For it is written, as I live, saith the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess to God.
Yeah, and when every knee shall bow down, it means to worship. That's been said, that every knee shall bow down to me. You see, that's worship. And that's why they say that in the book of Revelation, there's also been mentioned the name Magi, Magia, magic, sorcery, Greek 3095. Okay, that's Revelation, and also Acts 8. Yeah, this is magic, and this is it's been a little bit off the line here. And this has been mentioned as being sorcerer, the people who are using magic, are being sorcerer in Revelation 28:8.
Yes, and that reads, but the fearful and unbelieving and the abominable and murderers and whoremongers and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death.
Yeah, and sorcerers, Greek 5332, is been translated from the Greek word pharmakeos. It's pharmacy, a druggist, a poisoner.
Yeah, a magician, a sorcerer. So yeah, really, it's sorcery.
Yeah, so that's why I think that drugs being used to set people in the spirit of Satan. On the medical.
Well, you know, it's interesting, Michael, because, you know, we have poison, we have drugs, we also have something now that's just so incredibly, what can we call this, synthetic, is this transhumanism, this idea of artificial intelligence, quote unquote, artificial intelligence, planting instructions in the mind through the use of technology. How wicked of a sorcery that is. I mean, it's just yuck.
People think they do that for good, for their own good. Yeah, because someone tells them, oh, you have to do this pill and you have to do that. And there are even doctors out there, for example. One prominent example is Mr. Timothy Leary, which is a so-called LSD pope, which said proclaimed that everyone should take LSD with the super vision of the doctor. Now you see that's what actually the 1968 movement and the Summer of Love and everything else was about. and the Beatles and the psychedelic rock means psychedelic drugs. It's drug music.
Yeah, put the gun to his head and pull the trigger. Now he's dead, eh?
Yeah. Oh, we're great. Coming. I think we're coming now to that. Look at this thing here. It's a short video of about, I think, 30 seconds from a video of a concert with Queen and, of course, Freddie Mercury as a frontman and singer and the speaker and the messenger of his God, so-called God of this world, from the Londoner rock temple called the Rainbow. This is from a video I have researched on YouTube and also from someone who has got this album. And he said, the four, meaning the members of Queen, in London, Rock Temple, the Rainbow, started with a terrific live concert, which was only released decades later for whatever reason. Well, I could give you one reason, because there is one interesting note or claim that Mr. Freddie Mercury actually did on stage. And it was 1974, so 1 year before the publishing of the Bohemian Rhapsody. This is a video still from that video. And you see here, I have seen the entire concert. This concert is about 52 minutes long, and it appears on exactly 43 minutes and 4 seconds. That Mr. Freddie Mercury is showing his left hand path also is a code for black magic. And what he's using for a glove? A black glove, huh?
In a black suit too, with black hair and black eyeliner.
Yeah, and he's wearing diamonds. Huh? Ezekiel 28, anyone?
Yeah, that's right.
And this is from a website called metalheadzone.com. Freddie Mercury's, it's not my interpretation, but it supports my interpretation, Freddie Mercury's secret deal with the devil exposed by himself. So the Freddie Mercury Club set live at the Rainbow in 1974, so 1 year before Bohemian Rhapsody. We will show you that video, but we will first go into the lines what Freddie Mercury told the public audience. Thank you very much. Do you like my claws? So claws could be also a reference to the huma bird, because we know it's a predator, so they have claws. Do you like my claws? But he's speaking of his glove at the moment. So he's depicting himself as a kind of an animal, because he said, it's my, do you like my claws? But he's not speaking of my fingers, as a human would do. He's speaking of claws, like a predator would have. Okay. So he depicts himself as a kind of an animal. What did he say, Brett? On stage, I'm a devil, but yeah. I'm hardly a social reject. Do you like my claws? They are real diamonds. It's a present from the devil himself. You don't believe me? They don't believe me. Well, Mr. Freddie Mercury, considering the fact that you spoke about Mama, I just killed a man, considered in Bohemian Rhapsody, considered that you made lyrics and songs and made lots of money and fame in this world with Killer Queen, Another One Bites the Dust, It's a Kind of Magic, I Want to Break Free, Who Wants to Live Forever. I'd say that you're an open Satanist. And therefore, I'm not surprised that you got a present from the devil himself. And I'm not surprised either that you wrote after the concert, after that the devil, which is your claim, presented you real diamonds or fortune in this world by the merchants of the earth have waxed rich. that in Bohemian Rhapsody, you talked about Mama just killed a man. In Bohemian Rhapsody, you talked about Bismillah, which is, means in the name of Allah, we will not let you go, because if you sign a contract with the devil, either physically or spiritually, they will not let you go. And he said, okay then, well, anyway, the wind blows doesn't really matter, because he's got his fame. His only goal was to become a legend. He didn't want to be a rock star. He wanted to become a legend. He wanted to be remembered when he's gone. So he wanted to have a fast life, a glamorous life, and that's what he got. And he said, Beelzebub has put a devil beside me. 1 year, or maximum 1 year, after this concert in the Rainbow in 1974. He said, it's a present from the devil himself. They don't believe me. And 1 year later, he said that, well, I killed a man. And Bismillah, in the name of God. And he said that, well, Beelzebub has put a devil inside me. Yeah, you figure it out on your own. But that's what Freddie Mercury told out in the open. And he also told you some other things. And these sessions we are doing together, Brad and me, are simply the foundation for your own study. So please do your own research. And please think about the Bible, the King James Bible 1611, what they are telling you about worldly possessions in the Bible. And think about how much the disciples of Jesus Christ had, or many other men who are real followers of Jesus Christ had. They were just quite the opposite of Mr. Freddie Mercury. But he can speak out in the open and people don't believe him. And that's why I said, well, if he was claiming that he received real diamonds from the devil, then Mr. Freddie Mercury ends just like Goethe's Dr. Faustus, who made a contract with the devil himself, called Mephistopheles in Goethe's book. Faust, F-A-U-S-T. It's a worldwide known book about dealing with the devil. But Dr. Faustus thought he was so smart he could outsmart the devil by just painting a pentagram on the surface so that the devil could not leave the room. So stupid. You cannot use any material symbol or material thing to protect you from the evil side, from the devil. D plus evil is devil. Means that Goethe also was either distracted or a liar or didn't know it better. But Goethe also had connections to the Freemasonry, as far as I know. But that is not the conclusion of this reading. I say that Freddie Mercury ends just like Goethe's Dr. Faustus or anyone else who's in contact with the dark side, because they have made a pact. They have made a contract. And so they had to commit their soul. And that's a tragedy. And that's where this all ends for each star who made a contract with the evil side. And this is a white paper. You are invited to do your studies on your own. I hope, or we hope, that we have laid a solid foundation. This was just an example of the band Queen, and you will find in any band who is worldwide famous and waxed rich, that it's not in line with the King James Bible 1611, and they are not on the narrow path to salvation. And on that, I give it over to my beloved brother Brett. Thank you very much for listening. Bye-bye.
Yes, Michael, thank you very much for doing the research. And this reminds me of Revelation chapter 18 at the very end of the chapter. I definitely would recommend that you would read it yourself, but I'm going to read verse 21 through 24 to wrap it up. And a mighty angel took up a stone like a great millstone and cast it into the sea, saying, "Thus with violence shall that great city Babylon be thrown down and shall be found no more at all." And the voice of harpers and musicians and of pipers and of trumpeters shall be heard no more at all in thee. And no craftsman of whatsoever craft shall be found any more in thee. And the sound of a millstone shall not be heard no more at all in thee. And the light of a candle shall shine no more at all in thee. And the voice of the bridegroom and of the bride shall be heard no more at all in thee. For thy merchants were the great men of the earth. For by thy sorceries were all nations deceived. And in her was found the blood of prophets and of saints and of all that were slain upon the earth. And that wraps it up. God bless, and Maranatha.